गुड मॉर्निंग, वंदे मातरम, वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू. सो द टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन फॉर दिस मॉर्निंग विल बी ऑन स्पिरिट इज द क्राउन ऑफ यूनिवर्सल एग्जिस्टेंस. दिस इज पार्ट थ्री ऑफ एम एंड ऑब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ आवर योगा. सो दिस इज द थर्ड पार्ट ऑफ दिस डिस्कशन वी हैव सीन. सो it is a fourth part of this discussion. We have taken three classes previously in brief. This is the fourth session we are going to take. Spirit is the crown of universal existence. That is, today's discussion is exclusively from Sri Aurobindo's writings. Sri Aurobindo quotes, Spirit is the crown of universal existence. Matter is its basis. Spirit is the crown, matter is the basis, mind is the link between the two. So we have seen here mind, matter and spirit. Spirit is the crown of all universal existence, matter is the basis and the mind is the link between the two. And then spirit is which is eternal, and the mind is matter are its working. That is the difference. Spirit is the eternal, mind and the matter are its workings. So then again we are going forward. A spirit which is concealed, we can't see, because you know it is in many terms you use or behold while analyzing Sri Aurobindo's yoga. Concealed, hidden, passive, inhabitant, behind the veil, so many ways you discuss the things. So spirit is which is that which is concealed and has to be revealed. That is concealed, okay, no problem, you have seen. But the thing is that it will never be concealed till the time immemorial. It has got its expression, it has to come out, it has to begin its role, it has to start play its part. So it has to be revealed as it is concealed. Mind and body are a means by which it seeks to reveal. So this is the difference. It is spirit is concealed, it has to be revealed, and there itself you can find the mind and body are the means in by which it is seeks to reveal. Spirit seeks to reveal through mind and body, and spirit is the image of the Lord of Yoga. That is another difference. So we can find another difference. Spirit is the image of the Lord of Yoga. Image of the Lord of Yoga, but mind and body are its means. He has provided for reproducing that image in phenomenal existence. These are the images, and he has provided it for the image, for reproducing that image in phenomenal existence. All nature is an attempt at a progressing revelation of the concealed truth. So whatever is being done, whatever we see, wherever you go, the thing is that all nature here, all nature is an attempt at a progressive revelation of the concealed truth and more successful reproduction of the divine image. So this this is the thing we have seen till now. The difference, four sets of difference between spirit and versus mind and body. So here all natures, here in the course, all nature is an attempt at a progressive revelation of the concealed truth. Truth is concealed, progressive revelation of the concealed truth, and more successful reproduction of the divine image. Reproduction of the divine image. It is concealed. Now it's a progressing revelation of the concealed image. Step by step it is going on. And here spirit is doing everything. It was initially passive, concealed, hidden. Now itself it is working towards revelation through mind and body. Against here in the course, but what nature aims at for the mass in a slow evolution? So this is the evolution, that process is slow. Why is this slow? Because people are not interested. People are not interested, so what they will do? Just imagine you are going, suppose you are traveling somewhere, you have got your car. So immediately, or you have booked a car, or somewhere you have actually borrowed one car somebody for something. So now once you start, it is unless otherwise it is required, you will never stop anywhere. But when you are traveling by bus, it has got many options, many problems. Anywhere it has to go to the bus stop, it has to wait for man. Suppose something is there, it has to take that care. Suppose there is no people, there is a chance of cancellation. Suppose bus is on reservation, then you can find that day, it will be very difficult to get the bus. So many ways you handle the problems, and these problems are arising. But once you have got the taxi or car or Ola with you, immediately you will start and you will reach there. Unless otherwise that deep recurrence of inconveniences are occurring, so you can find your own way. It's like this. In the normal evolution, this normal town bus is going. Suppose that is up to its own speed. They are going to have some people. They want to do some business. Suppose according to their convenience, they drive. But once this yogic path is concerned, that was the traditional path, evolutionary path, that is very slow. And once this you go for the yoga, the path of the yoga, it affects for the individual by the rapid revolution. It works by quickening of all the energies. So rapid revolution, quickening of our energies, and sublimation of the difficulties. So what we have to do? Nature seeks the divine in her own symbol. Nature seeks the divine in her own symbols. Yoga goes beyond nature. So as per the regular traditional habits, traditional way, nature following the traditional duties. But the thing is that once yoga that goes beyond nature to the Lord of nature. Yoga goes beyond the nature to Lord of nature. We are now confined towards the nature, even if we are not reaching the peak. So nature, so yoga goes beyond, that is a beautiful message really. Yoga goes beyond the nature to the Lord of nature, beyond the universe to the transcendent, and can return with the transcendent light and power with the fiat of the omnipotent. This is a great thing. So what does the really we see in the process of evolution? Nature holds a lot of things. But thing is that once you pursue the path of yoga, yoga goes beyond the nature to what? To the Lord of nature. Say again, in the course, beyond the universe to the transcendent, and can return with the transcendent light, going to the beyond the universe to the transcendent, and after going and reaching the transcendent, what it is doing, yoga, can return with the transcendent light and power with a fiat of the omnipotent. For what? It will come with this light, truth, power of the transcendent into this lower hemisphere, into this mind and life and body, and the purpose is to transform them. Again, we can get another bright line. The object of yoga, object of our yoga, because Sri Aurobindo has categorically emphasized a lot of things. We can see the object of our yoga is to enter into and be possessed. One thing is to enter into and be possessed by the divine presence and consciousness. So this is the purpose. The object of yoga is to enter into and be possessed by the divine presence and consciousness. Again, to love the divine for the divine sake alone. To love the divine for the divine sake alone, and be turned into in our nature, into the nature of the divine. Turn the human nature, limited human nature, to the divine nature, and in our will and works and life, will and works and life, to be instrument of the divine. That is a great thing, Sri Aurobindo has quoted. And our works, life and will must be an instrument of the divine. The divine alone is our object, nothing else. Very important thing. Sri Aurobindo tried to clarify to us in a very glittering way. Nothing to hear, very small message, but it contains a lot of significance. Its depth is very much profound. The object of our yoga, I'll try to quote it again because it is very touching. It's really real truth. So many ways you can find the hidden truth in this message. The object of our yoga is to enter into and be possessed, enter into, be possessed by the divine presence and consciousness. Again, to love the divine for the divine's sake alone. And then to be turned your nature to the nature of the divine in our will and works and our life to be the instrument of the divine. So that is the divine alone is our object. Nothing else, no one else, only the divine, that is the object of our object is thus. So here, as here in the course, the soul lives in the material universe. Of that alone, it is immediately conscious. Soul is conscious, nothing else. In an unconscious world, it is the only conscious is the soul. The realization of its potentialities in that are the problems with which it is concerned. We can't able to realize it. It is there, the source of all, the stop of all, but we are yet to realize. But matter means the involution of the conscious delight of existence in self-oblivious force and in self-dividing. Infinitesimally disgraded form of existence, matter. That is the really it has in through the process of involution we have got the self oblivious form. So we can find it has been this matter actually we have seen means the involution, the conscious delight of existence, concert and like. Conscious delight of existence in self-oblivious force and in self-dividing, infinitesimally disgraded form of substance, here matter, that is spirit. Therefore, the whole principle and effort of the material world must be evolution. Involution, you have reached the matter and it is the opposite force, opposite direction you have to go, that is the process of evolution. Of what it is involved now, it has to get in, that is involved, things that are involved must be evolved. So it is in the process of evolution and development of what it undeveloped must be developed, what is involved must evolve. Now here everything is shut up from the past in the violently working inconscient sleep of material force. Therefore the whole aim of any material becoming must the working of consciousness out of inconscient. Very interesting. Working of consciousness, waking of consciousness from the inconscient. The whole consummation of the material becoming must the removal of the veil of the matter. Now it is veiled, it must be removed. And luminous revelation, not only revelation, the luminous revelation of the entirely self-conscient. That is the purpose of yoga. Again, being to the own impersonal soul, being to its impersonal soul is to become, is the in the becoming. Being to its own imprisoned soul in the becoming. Since man is such an imprisoned soul, this luminous liberation and the coming to self-knowledge must be highest object and the condition of the perfection. That is what it must be. Two beautiful things Sri Aurobindo tried to quote. Since man is such an imprisoned soul, this luminous liberation, it has to be liberated, and coming to the self-knowledge must be the highest object of this condition of perfection. That is very important, Sri Aurobindo quoted, that liberation to the highest luminousness, self-knowledge, and that is the object and condition of perfection. Then Sri Aurobindo quotes, the Gnostic perfection, spiritual in nature, is to be accomplished here in body and takes life in the physical world. That gnosis, that accomplishment has to be done here. In one of the fields, even though gnosis opens the possession of planes and worlds beyond the material universe, that speaks of the gnosis. Then the physical body is therefore the basic of action, pratishtha, which can't be despised, neglected, or excluded from the spiritual embodiment, because most of the time we have mentioned karjam basadayat saridam papatayat, but here in integral yoga it holds a body, holds a better base. So perfection of the body in the outer instrument of the complete divine living on earth will be the necessarily the part of the Gnostic convention, Vande Mataram.